Of all the things to cause my very first attack on another player in D&D, I never thought it would be horses. Now, our party consists of a firbolg druid named Krarus, an artificer warforge named Scream, or more accurately, yes, that is his actual name, and an ASMR paladin named Havoon, and finally a gnome wizard, which I play, named Keltina. Now, you might have noticed that two of these classes are intelligence-based. Well, let me assure you, this party only has a singular brain cell, and it belongs to Keltina most of the time. Usually when we have an ethical dilemma, it goes over to Krarus because Keltina is fairly unethical, but most of the time it sticks with her. Well, this is the story of one time it went to Krarus, and it didn't go very well. So essentially what happened is we needed to get to a city that was a little ways away, and so the party decided that the best way to get there would be to get a carriage and some horses. Our paladin, Havoon, was not there that day because their player was out sick, and so the rest of us decided that we were just going to kind of take it slow, just kind of have a relatively chill day where we would just travel to the next city and then we would do the stuff there with them. Well, as it turned out, it was not a chill day because Keltina and Scream made the very poor decision of giving Krarus the one brain cell and sending him out to go find some horses. Now, Krarus, as I mentioned, is a firbolg druid. As such, he can talk to animals, and as such, he very much feels for animals. So, you see, it was quite reasonable of him when he saw these poor, helpless horses trapped by this horrible spiked wooden fence that just kept them from roaming free as they should be. Naturally, he wanted to free them, and so he did what any reasonable druid would do. He transformed into a bear, knocked down the fence, and scared them until they ran away. I mean, wouldn't you do the exact same thing? There's nothing more reasonable to do in that situation than, of course, to transform into a bear. So, you know, he does this. And several horses go out running, and he goes ahead and collects the horse, and we go ahead to meet up with him, and we see Krarus with a few horses, four horses, and we see a broken wooden fence, and we see some more horses running about, panicking, and Keltina says, "Okay, I'm gonna need that brain cell back," takes it back, goes out, and proceeds to try and straighten out the whole situation, which goes surprisingly well. Turns out, if you make yourself look like you have a bunch of scratches and act like you got mauled by a bear, people don't ask many questions. Funny that. So we take our new found horses, and their names are Monty, Felwell, Dio, and Buttons. Yes, I have memorized that. I can show you my notes at the end of this video to prove it. I just have letters on my notes. But we have these four wonderful horses, and we go ahead and start proceeding to the next city. Well, you see, our group doesn't exactly have the best conversationalists. Between Keltina, who's a bookworm, Scream, who just likes building stuff all the time, and Havoon, who constantly has to spend time justifying each of our actions as a party internally, we don't really talk that much. We just kind of sit there quietly, so no one can blame Krarus when he naturally starts talking to the only things he can, the horses. I mean, speak with animals exists for a reason, right? And that reason is to have travel partners of horses tell you their various favorite kinds of apples and various living situations, because that's exactly what he did as we went to the next city. And the idea was originally that we were going to use them to travel, and then we were going to set them free. This is an idea that Krarus came up with, but was quickly seen as not the brightest when we get to the city and notice some giant flying lizards with giant teeth, just kind of circling around, doing the rounds. And we go ahead and think about this for a second, put the pieces together and go, horse, giant winged lizard creature. I don't think they're both making it out there alive, and I don't think Monty is going to be the one that survives. And so naturally, we were like, all right, Krarus, we can't set him free now, but we're just going to go ahead and board the horses at this nice place. They're going to get pampered, they're going to get food and cared for, and it's going to be great. So We spend our time in that city. We go ahead and travel to another city via teleportation, naturally. Go about a whole bunch of very, very, very important and stressful story stuff. But in the background, quite literally, when Keltina wakes up from probably the hardest night of her life, the first thing that gets said after coping with all of this stuff is, when are we going to return to get the horses? They were that high on our priority list. And so finally, we got done with some of the story stuff and decided it was time to go back and free the horses. But you see, now Havoon's player is back. Our ASMR paladin is back. And surprisingly enough, he has an opinion on this whole stealing horses thing. In his opinion, it is wrong to take another's property. Now, I know this opinion doesn't make any sense because if you're like Kraris, you think, oh no, horses aren't property, they're people. I mean, they've got feelings, they've got opinions, they can talk and hold discussions. You can't just imprison and enslave them. Like, animals? I mean, the term animals is basically a slur anyway. And so our paladin and our druid, Havoon and Kraris, start arguing about this. And in real time, this argument probably takes around 30 minutes. And me, as Keltina's player, I'm like, she does not have a tolerance for this. So the first thing I do is go ahead and have her zone out for a bit. I have a familiar or an animal that I can look through the eyes of. So I go ahead, send it to the roof, watch the sunset. Then I go ahead and come back down and they're still arguing. More time passes and they are still arguing. And now Scream is taken aside. Now Scream is on the side of Kraris. And so Havoon is trying to fight Scream and Kraris. Scream, who doesn't act like a very intelligent player or character, by the way. They just kind of do whatever. But they're just having this argument. And so Keltina is like, okay. We got a mission because she has just received a communication from the city that the horses are from that they need to head there as soon as they can. And so she's like, all right, we have to leave in the morning and I do not want them to all be freaking exhausted, which would leave me on watch and I am not observant because I am constantly studying spells on when we're riding home. So I need these stupid party members to go to sleep. So she goes down and she tries to end the argument reasonably with logic and such. And it does not work. Logic does not work on these people, you see, because without the one brain cell, they are immune to logic. And so Keltina goes up to them and she's like, screw it. I'm casting sleep. And so she does. And she puts the person with the current lowest hit points to sleep, which at the time is Kraris. And so Kraris falls, and with Kraris gone, now Scream, who had just been kind of a lower down person on the whole horse revolution side of the argument, now has to take full force and also wants a little bit of revenge. So after Keltina and the bartender go ahead and lug Kraris back up into his bed, for those that don't know, firbolgs are like at least human size, but probably bigger. Gnomes are 3 feet tall, so... And she is not, my character is not buff, so we're lugging this guy up the stairs to his bed. And Keltina finally, after all of this is done, is just ready to sleep. She's just done, she's just tired. And Scream decides it's time to get his revenge. And so his player goes ahead and has Scream try to touch Keltina's pillow and enchant it so that it'll scream wake up whenever she touches it. Now the DM at this point says quite wisely, are you trying to do this sneakily? To which the player replies, no. To which the DM says, Keltina, you notice that he's doing this. And so I, as Keltina's player, being a little bit tired with this whole discussion myself, go ahead and tell him that Keltina is giving him a glare and he can see fire in her eyes as she does so. And then she tries to go back to sleep. And you know what this Scream does? You know what he does? He touches the pillow anyway. And so as his hand touches the pillow, Keltina spins around and launches the best firebolt of her life at him. And when I say the best firebolt of her life, I mean it, because she rolled a freaking natural 20. That is where luck is necessary, people. She rolls a natural 20 and just rolls a 9 and a 10 on the damage dice for level 5, so she's got 2d10s. So that's 38 fire damage, which is freaking ridiculous for a cantrip. Like, this does not even require a spell to be used, and it is doing this much damage. That is absolutely insane. And so Scream goes ahead and realizes that this is not a fight that he can win. And he goes ahead and he lies down and he gives up. Now, I wish that this whole argument ended there, but the fact is it didn't. When we ended the session at that point for that night, I decided, as the overachiever scholar type person that I am, that, you know what, this problem needs a resolution, and I have taken bioethics, and bioethics has talked about animals, so I should be able to write this, right? And so I decide to spend 2 hours of my night. I mean, it's already midnight, so I just stay up till 2 a.m. It's the summer, who cares? And I write a reasoned argument as to why the horses have a right to stay and live in a safe environment, because it is their choice to do so, and they do so of their own volition, and to take them out of that environment is essentially disrespecting their desires and wants. And so anyways, I write this whole essay, a week passes, and we have our next session. And the intro for the session, when we all start signing in to Zoom, is, all right, who's ready for the horse debate? And we're all just like, all right, yeah, I got my arguments prepared. We all had our arguments prepared for this stupid horse debate. And so the session begins, and we go ahead and start flinging all of these arguments at each other. Kraris coming in full force with all of his arguments for horse liberties and horse freedoms, and we should respect what they want. And then Haboon with all of his arguments of it's people's property, and people have a right to their property, and we can't just go disrespecting the system that's been around for years. Like, we don't have the power to do that. Are we gonna free every horse that we see on our travels? And this debate goes on for some time, and Keltina kind of contributes points where she can. And eventually we come to a settlement that we should ask the horses what they want, because truly it is their opinion that matters the most in their lives. And so we ask them, and we say, all right, horses, would you rather be free out in the wilderness, or would you rather go back to where you used to live? And you know what our DM made these horses say to that question? Can you guess? Can you guess just by the exasperation that I am giving you right now? The horses proceeded to say, oh, you know, home? Yeah, that's nice. That's nice. But freedom, freedom. That's nice also. That's really nice. That's nice. You know, griffins? Griffins not so nice. There's a griffin at home, and that's not so nice, but The flying lizard things? Those, not so nice either, not so nice. Apples are nice. And this continues on for some time. And we, as the players, are just in a mix of laughter and just exhaustion and just disbelief. It is just an incredible cacophony of emotions, and I'm just resigned at that point. I'm just like, alright, we are bringing them home, because they will be safer at home, and obviously these horses are too frickin' dumb to be let out into the wilderness if they can't even decide. And so Kraris relents after some time arguing, and he goes ahead and he starts asking these horses his final questions, like what their favorite apples are and all of this stuff. And we go ahead and we finally make it to the town, and of course Kraris goes out and buys apples and buys sugar cubes, and as we go ahead and return them to their owner via Scream transforming into a guard and claiming that we had found them somewhere, as we go ahead and they are finally closed back into their encounter, we have the most emotional moment of the campaign up until that point, where Kraris goes ahead and he stands by the fence and he reaches out a hand with a sugar cube, another hand with a Green Apple, that has been said to be his favorite horse's favorite apple. I believe Thelwell was his favorite horse. I'm not 100% sure on that. But he goes ahead and he reaches these things out and he feeds the horses. And it's a very touching moment. It's a very emotional moment. And it actually leads to some discussions that occur kind of like if someone had died. Discussions that were that deep because of these frickin' horses that we decided to steal one day because our local moral compass was not present. And so, that is the story of the horses. And what a story it was. It spanned so many sessions, probably took up hours and hours of our time, probably around like 4 hours in total if I had to guess, maybe more. More if you count the time I spent writing the essay. It was a whole thing. But in conclusion, I don't think I would have done it any other way. Except for all of it, which I would have tried to avoid. And Kraris is not getting to leave whenever animals are involved ever again. So, that's the story of the horse revolution. I hope you all enjoyed it. If you did, go ahead and leave a like on the video. If you want to see more D&D stories, go ahead and let me know in the comments. But anyways, thank you guys so much for watching, and I hope that you all soar high and enjoy your ride of life. Bye!